The elementary principles of the Christian faith, of the faith. We read, as we did last week, and we'll continue as we look at what the writer to the Hebrews has listed as six pieces of knowledge that he says we ought to already have. But we don't have to feel so bad because we've got the excuse of 2,000 years. They only had the excuse of maybe 25, 30, 40 years before the Christ event and their receiving it. So they forgot a lot sooner than perhaps we did. But as we read over those items of the faith, it's awful easy to say, ooh, golly, yeah, I don't know if I could explain that or not. And he says that we ought to have these down already and be able to move on to other things. We want to take a look at that and why he is saying that, to whom he is saying that, and how we might hear that. He's calling all of this milk, baby food. Okay, he's calling it baby food. And the stuff that you start out on. Okay, so it's needed, necessary, and it's always good to return to. Now last week, remember, we looked at principle number one, which was repentance from dead works. And we looked at that and what that means and how that is God's calling, sort of our awakening to the reality that if we seek something, anything other than God, or if we seek anything from some other source than God, that is dead works. Because that which cannot satisfy is outside of God. That which we were created for is God. And so this awakening, this calling to repent, to turn around, to come back to the source, to be again with God, is the first and primary principle. And it is a lot like the first step, as I said last week, in a 12-step system that AA uses. And that is, we find ourselves powerless. Okay? Anytime we find ourselves like the original parents, Adam and Eve, looking to gain something on their own, okay, apart from God, that's dead works. Dead people do dead things. No, dead people don't do anything. Living people don't do dead things. We're called to life. And so what this teaching is God calling us back to God's self, saying, hey, you can try all you want over there, but I wired you up. I created you for myself. You're going to find your best enjoyment, your fulfillment, the answer to all your questions, the question to all your answers, only in God. Come back. Turn around. That's a great, great first step. It's the basis of lots of things. Let's look at this passage again that is on the front of your bulletin. And we'll remain there, but let's take a look at it from the Amplified Bible. This is a Bible that tries to put all the possibilities of translations in there. And it's good for study. He says, therefore, let us get past the elementary stage in the teachings about the Christ. Now, getting past doesn't mean that we leave him behind. Okay? Like I said last week, if you are on the top of the skyscraper, you're standing on the foundation as well. You can't stand on the top. You can't do away with the foundation. You still have the top floor. Okay? So you're not getting past means that you're moving forward. You're not just leaving behind, though. It goes with you. It's the foundation. It stacks. So let us get past the elementary stage in teachings about the Christ, advancing on to maturity and perfection and spiritual completeness. This is what we are called to do. The first calling comes, repent. That is, the answer is God. The question is God, and everything in between is God. He's our Alpha and our Omega, our A to Z, our first and last. He is our all in all. And since he's our all in all, and he's calling us back to himself, and he's doing so in order that we can be transformed, that we will change, that this maturity, this perfection, this spiritual completeness. He says, doing this without laying again the foundation. Okay, so to do that, he wants to move on and do that, move into the good stuff, without having to go back and lay again the foundation. So you already got this stuff. And he says, what it is you've got? You've got a foundation, which is the repentance from dead works and the faith toward God, of teaching about washings or oblations, ritual purifications, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. These are all important matters in which you should have been proficient long ago. He's talking about milk. And the second principle today that we're talking about, after the call to awaken, to repent, to turn back around, to come to God, we are told that faith toward God is that second principle. Faith toward God. Now, that seems a little strange when you think about it, that the foundations of the faith, the foundations of Christianity, the foundations of anything, you know, if you're talking about the foundations of faith, you would think that, well, faith in God is essential. It's sort of like saying, if you're going to be a human being, if you're going to be a human being, you got to breathe. Okay, that's sort of a given. Okay, I'm going to breathe. I'm a human being. Having faith toward God seems like it ought to be in that list too. So we wonder, why is he writing this? What is he talking about? Because in Scripture, as we approach it, when that which is really sort of obvious and you wonder, it must mean something else is there. So if we look at faith and we symbolize it as a candle, okay, I don't know how you want to symbolize faith, but let's just say a burning candle. It's lit, okay, that symbolizes our faith. What is this faith toward God? Well, polls have shown that basically, in the United States anyways, 9 out of 10 human beings believe in something. 9 out of 10 human beings believe in God, or a higher power, or a spiritual source, or a whatever. But they believe in something other than themselves, okay? So they believe, let's say they believe in God. 9 out of 10 people, okay? And so we could, you know, find out what it is that they believed about, but you know what, I really don't care, because what they believe about isn't what the Scripture is talking about, because we weren't around when the Scripture was written. I don't know what he's talking about to the people he's writing to, what he's talking about faith toward God back then. Some of the concepts we have today he might have had back then, they might not have had, but they were talking about something specific. So when we look at faith, and we ask, what is the faith he is talking about at the time this letter is being written to the Hebrews? Historically, it's been sort of legendary that Paul was the author, but we don't really think it was Paul. It might have been somebody writing under Paul's authority, but needless to say, it was something that was known by all the churches. It was Catholic in that it was known everywhere by everyone, so it was a part of the canon. And so this faith, this person writing to the Hebrews, the Jews, okay, what is this faith toward God, and what would it mean to them? So we're going to have to look at that first century, second temple, time of Jesus, all of the different groups and people of Jews there in Israel. And there were a plethora. There were so many different types and kinds. It didn't have just one flavor. You know, it wasn't just the historic Jewish faith They were as diverse as perhaps we are today. But let's call it Jewish, okay? We won't look at Persian or the Medes or the Greeks or anybody else because there's a lot of different thoughts. Let's just stick with that which is Jewish, because we know that that is where our Savior comes from. The Messiah is the Savior of the Jews, okay? And we're included and grafted in. But we know it comes from this Jewish faith. So in looking at all things Jewish, what would have been the faith toward God meaning for them? Well, we know from Holy Scripture that there are Levites and there are priests. These are the professional clergy. These are the guys who make their living from this religious business, okay? Sort of like me, and I'm not alone today. There are fellow clergy and extra clergy, and we're glad that you are here worshiping with us today. I won't point you out, but you're sitting right over there, and we welcome you. So these are there are professional Levites, priests, people that are taking care of the temple, and they have specific duties to do, and we read that in the Old Testament, and we read it in the time of Jesus. Jesus has run-ins with Levites and priests. There's also the Sadducees. This is an important group. This is a group that is there until there is no more temple. The Sadducees are the elite. The Sadducees are the people that have the prestige and the power. They are the people who basically think they're it. They're it. They're the ruling class. They're the ones. They're the one percenters. They're the one percenters in a lot of ways. I'm not going to assign them to a political party because they didn't have it back then. But this political party, the Sadducees, and it was political because there was no separation of politics and religion. It was all one thing at that time. And the Sadducees were those that had very specific beliefs, and those beliefs all tied to the temple. It was about temple sacrificial religion that God had instructed them to do through the first five books of Moses. Okay? So you have the Sadducees. Okay, and we also know the Pharisees. A lot of times you hear Jesus commenting about the Pharisees, and a lot of times we think that the Pharisees are icky people, they're no good. But one of the things you got to remember, especially biblically, is those of a particular group are the ones that criticize themselves the most. Where do you get most criticism from? You get most criticism about the Pharisees. It says in some of the ancient writings there were seven types of Pharisees. Pharisees were lay people. It was a lay movement that was interested in being holy, being separated, being good, being righteous. And some of them, you know, did it in a way that made them unrighteous and made them unholy. And there's a whole array of them. Paul, Saul of Tarsus, Pharisee. So there's that group. There's also the Essenes. The Essenes were people that believed that the Sadducees and the Pharisees were whacked out and that they were evil and that they were no good. And so they went out and they did sort of an Amish thing in the wilderness. They lived and they're on top of Masada at the end. And they're a celibate group that lasts for a long time. But they're a group that doesn't marry. They're a group that continually looks for Messiah. And they have a long history in Israel. They've been around for a while, and they continue until one faithful day that we'll talk about in a minute. We also have the royal party, the Herodians. The Herodians, those who are with King Herod and those who have sort of a wedded state power and church power and royal power, and it's all together. Each one of these groups thinks something just a little bit differently about what it means to have faith toward God. The scribes are the professional scholars. They're the ones that normally you think scribes scribble, they're the ones writing, but they're actually scholars. They're the ones that are poring over the Torah and over the writings, and again, a professional bunch of clergy types. You also have the zealots. These are people who were Jews that believed they should take things into their own hands, that they should get rid of the oppressor Rome, and just like they did the oppressor the Greeks, and they should have their independence again, and they believed that really God needed a little help, and they were going to help them. And so they were a very political group as well as religious. And within that subcategory were the Skahari. The Skahari were the assassins. They were guys, the Skahari is a little knife that they would carry, and as they walked through the crowded places, they would stick it in the kidneys of one of the Roman soldiers, and they would assassinate them. So you have this plethora of people at the time of Jesus, each of them having just a little bit different, okay, political and religious platform. They did not believe all in the same. For instance, the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. Okay, the Pharisees did. The Essenes did. The Sadducees didn't believe in angels. The Pharisees did. Different things, different platforms. So, what is this new faith, these Christians, and what is this faith towards God that the Hebrew writer is talking about to these people? What is that faith? Well, as that faith goes forward until the year 70 AD. This is an extremely important date, because what happens in 70 AD is all those groups we just looked at are gone, except one. The rest of them are destroyed, disbanded, they fall apart. The temple is destroyed by the Romans, and it is no more. And since it is no more, the Sadducees, whose faith and religion has to do with the temple, they just disappear out of history because they no longer have a temple for sacrificial wisdom. So all of the people and all of the belief systems and all of the theologies and everything that's going on that could tell us what faith towards God meant are gone. Are gone. Except for two. From 70 AD, we have two forms of Judaism that from the ashes of destruction move forward, parallel even to today. And those two are the Jews that we call today, that come out of rabbinical Judaism, the Pharisees, okay, and the Nazarene Jews. They were also called the Way or Christians. These two ancient forms of Judaism are the only ones that survive after the destruction of the temple, and they move forward. They move forward. So the faith that they are talking about these things in a foundation, the repentance, right? The faith towards God, all of these things, all of this milk is common to both groups. To both groups. Those things that are on the front of your bulletin that you read can be and are embraced by Jews and Christians. There's nothing there that is particularly just one or the other. All six of those things are held in common. They're the basis of the faith. The faith comes out of one historic place. It takes and goes in two directions and runs parallel, but it comes from the same exact place. And these people called the Hebrews, who the letter is written to, right? The letter is written to the Jews, to the Hebrews. Well, some of them at this point in time, they get to figuring that, there's that part always of society that, you know, sometimes we just want to go along and get along. We've had enough of controversy. We've had enough of fighting. We've had enough of, you know, disagreement. We've had enough of you know, bad feelings towards other groups and stuff. And we just say, why don't we just, you know, just, let's just stay. Don't we all just worship the same God? You hear that a lot. The writer to the Hebrews says, yes, but, yes, however, those six things that you want to stick with, yes, it's true that the other Hebrews, the other Jews that are around, they embrace them too. They're a part of their faith too. But you have something that's a part of your faith that isn't a part of their faith. And you need to move on and grow. You can't just stick around because it's nice and everybody wants to play nice and can we all just get along. You need to grow up. And you need to see that God, who's in charge, has specific instructions and plans for you. For you. This whole idea of milk, faith toward God. Jews, Christians, it's one of the fundamentals. Last week, repentance from dead works. Every one of the Jews would be able to tell you the same thing. Yep, that's a fundamental of ours as well. Anything apart from God is no good. We share in common this. But what is it about faith toward Christ for a Christian that is different? That is different. Well, I think getting the foundation is what the Hebrew letter wants us to do, and that's important to do for us to understand that and to be embraced by that, because that is true and common clear across the board for all Judaic Christian peoples. But what is this milk, this faith toward God, how is it different? If Jews and Christians fundamentally believe in the same things, then what's going on? Well, I think the best way to explain this is to tell you the tale of the two sisters. Once in time, there was a great king, and he had two daughters, and he loved his daughters very, very much. And he told them that I have to go away to do battle, but I promise that I will come back. And when I come back, I will give you each a string of pearls and a beautiful summer dress. You can believe me. You can count on me. When I come back, each of you will receive a string of pearls and a beautiful summer dress. Off to war he went. Months had passed, and because there was no internet, and there was no Wi-Fi, and there was no texting or CNN or anybody else to give us the news, you just didn't hear how things were going in a far-off country. You heard rumors and rumors of rumors, but you didn't really know what was going on. And the girls missed their daddy, and they longed for his return. Years passed. Many people said he's dead. He's got to be dead or he'd be back by now. Many people said, oh, he isn't coming. It was a one-time thing. He'd gone. Doesn't matter what he said, what he promised. You see, but the two daughters, they're the only ones who were told that they would get the string of pearls and the summer dress. And they held that in their heart. They held that with hope. They looked for signs and they prayed and they wanted their dad to come home. But years passed and years passed and years passed. No daddy. Then, a messenger was sent from the king. And the messenger came to the land, and these many years had passed. And he looked all over, and he only found one daughter. And so he told her, he said, your daddy is alive, and well and loves you beyond love. And he's come. And just so you know it's true, and he pulls out a string of pearls and he gives them to her. And she remembers what her daddy said, the promises that he had made, a string of pearls and a summer dress. Here was a foretaste, the promise that was given. That string of pearls. Soon, the messenger was caught by others and killed and was gone. The one daughter found her sister. And her and her sister, who both held the hope that God is coming to us because we can't go to God. God is coming to us. And the one sister has seen and has the pearls, has the proof, has the understanding. The other one doesn't. But still has the hope. The two sisters are like us and our brothers and sisters, the Jews. Same promise, same God. We, in having the resurrection of Jesus Christ, have the pearls. We have the proof. We have the hope that is above and beyond all hopes. We have the message that the King is alive and well, and he's coming back. His promises are trustworthy and true, and you can take it to the bank. And we who have the Christ are now joined with our faith toward God, like those who were before us. Romans says we were grafted into that great tree. Grafted into that great tree. That promise that we have of what the Messiah has done for us. We know on his return, when all is completed and done. What is faith toward God? It's part of our spiritual development. It's part of the way. It is a part of the reality. When God calls us to awaken, to, hey, you, how's that been going for you over there? You complain, you moan, you groan, you wonder if there's anything in life worthwhile. You wonder about this, you wonder about that. You want to do it on your own. How's that working? As soon as you're ready, God says, I'm over here. I'm over here. And I'm always waiting for you. And as soon as you wake up and turn around, you repent. What do? It says, repent from dead works. But it's more than just stopping. If repenting from dead works is all we had to do, then we would be doing nothing. But he says, oh no, that's just the beginning. You stop trying to do it on your own, trying to figure it out on your own, trying to make sense of it all on your own. You stop trying to get what you're not going to get from something that don't have what you want. You turn to God, and then your faith is toward God. He gives us step number two, faith toward God. He doesn't just leave, because Jesus also gives us a parable. He says, you know, once you cast out a demon, that's what baptism is, it's an exorcism. The powers of Satan are no more, boom. The demon, it says the devil leaves, and he goes out. He doesn't find anything too good, so he says, I'll go back, and he takes more with him. So when you sit empty because you've repented and you're not filled with anything, you're a good vacuum, you're good bait for more of what is not God. God says, when you repent, when you go empty, faith toward God. To God, to God, to God, to God. Everything you desire or have desired, if it is real, if it is meaningful, if it is of your heart and of your soul, it's of God. God has to give to you. That which you want to know can only be known by God. That God shaped hole in your soul cannot be plugged or filled or satisfied by anything or anyone else other than God. So the basis of the faith that we all share, both Jew and Christian, is that we are called to turn away from death, to stop going, trying to figure it out on our own, thinking we can get something that we don't have from something other than God, and stop doing those dead works, and turn toward God. Anything, and here's the difficult one, I just read that the latest poll had absolutely zero when non-Christian people in America were asked about their Christian neighbors and if they saw any difference. And they did not. They said there's absolutely no difference between them and us. Not in what they do, not in how they behave, not in what they say, where they go, how they spend their money. No difference. No difference. See, that is what we call sin. Anything other than God is sin. God says each and every moment, I created you for me. And what should fill each and every moment is God cannot be a hobby. He cannot be a pastime. He cannot be extracurricular. God will be central and all or nothing. When we're called to repent, it means toward God. And if we're toward God, if faith is toward God and in God, then that means that all of our questions are about God. All of our answers are God. All of our actions, God. What we look for is God. Anything apart from God is dead. Life is found in God and seeking Him first. Got milk? Let's pray. Holy One. Holy One. Your word just, I don't know about anybody else here, Lord, but your word just cut me quick to the heart. It just convicted me, Lord, because my to-do list, which, has so many things on it because I'm so important and I know that the universe would collapse without me, and I just know, Lord, that that to-do list, you're not even on it. Lord, we are lost. Let us hear your voice. Let us hear your call. Let us hear your tug. Let us come home to you and know that every minute of every day is about you. That you are pregnant in your creation. You're everywhere. You're always seeking us. You don't know how to leave us alone. Lord, may we wake up. May we seek. May we have that faith that always asks, what about God? And what about God now? And what about God now? And how is God here now? And how is God loving me and you now? And how is the power of God possible at all now? God is great and good and awesome. We will have time only for God. Period. End of sentence. Nothing else. It doesn't matter how many things we've got left to do. It doesn't matter how many projects we've got going on, or irons in the fire, or just how important we think we are. Reality is that in the last moment, when the trump blows and the earth and the sea give up their dead and Christ comes, we are 100% nothing else and but God. God. May we have the hunger and the thirst to chase after it now. In Him we pray, and let us say,
Amen.
Amen. If the ushers will come forward now, they will receive that portion of goodness we have received from God to return to God. And our offertory music today, you're doing the ukulele, right? Yeah. And it's not Tiny Tim. To look. It's something of God.